Christian witness, had a clear commitment and love for Christ. And we pray this morning that you would draw near to her, and that you would comfort her, and that she may know your presence with her, we pray. So do be with us this morning, and we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Jacob and Jonathan. So in the words of our first song, we continue to remember the Lord Jesus laying down his life that we might be set free. So let's sing together. This is Amazing Grace.
Breaks the power.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down.
Breaks the power.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down.
Above all kings, this is
Technical hitch in the middle of that song. I think getting rid of the little box started it again. So one of the things we love most as a church about the school holidays is that we often get students who were brought up in the Rock congregation back at home from the university term. It may be this year that students didn't ever manage to leave, but this morning David Palmer has very kindly offered to catch up with us and tell us a bit about what he's been up to. So thank you, David. First, for those who are new to the Rock congregation, do you just want to tell us briefly what your link to Rock is and also what you've been doing over this last academic year?
Sure. Hi, everyone. It's so good to see you. So many of you will know that I've grown up in Rock. Rock has been my home church family. And then since September, I've been involved in another church in Durham where I am studying geography.
That's great. Thank you. And what have been some of the highlights and the challenges of this last year since starting university?
So on a personal level, I really have struggled with discipline with my uni work. I'm normally very dependent on like structure and deadlines and external accountability to do my work. And so with all of that kind of fizzled out, and it's just because of COVID, it's on you to get your work done. There's very little structure. So that's something which I struggle with, discipline with work. And it's also frustrating not being able to be with friends at uni, not being able to make friends at uni, interacting with people, establishing friendships. That's been frustrating, but something that I and lots of others have tried to maintain by FaceTiming and calling and things like that. But it's harder to meet new people. Highlights. I'm very grateful. I feel like I've been able to get involved and feel very settled, awesome, faithful church family in Durham. Really welcoming, for example, some of the second and third years, took some of the first years out for a day at the beach within the first few weeks, things like that. And it's also where I've met the people that I'll be living with next year, with a few guys from church I'll be living with. I've got some really lovely flatmates this year, living in college, living in halls, which I'm grateful for. I've been doing a course alongside my geography studies, a beginner's Italian, which has been so much fun. I've really loved that. And I was in Durham for term one, and since then I've been away from Durham. So that was two months in Durham and 5 months at home, and then hopefully 2 months more in Durham. But being at home hasn't been all bad. I've really enjoyed the opportunity to reconnect with some friends from school and things like that.
That's great to hear. Good to hear there have been some highlights despite a very different freshers year from how it should have been. So some prayer points would be great. We'll be praying for you as a church and as your church family back in Cambridge, but some specific prayer points would be brilliant, so we can be praying for you.
Thanks. I'm just really grateful. I'm very thankful for my flatmates and for my church family in Durham, and all the ways I felt supported. That's something to give thanks for. I also appreciate prayer personally for my discipline with work. And I think, Aidan and Rebecca and others would also appreciate that. We're going into exam season, that we can glorify God through our work as well as other things. Another thing is I'll be serving as a co-leader of my college CU next year, and I guess that's something for me, but that's also for everyone. There's all the changeovers. We just really want to make the most of the coming year, but especially the next term. For those of us who live in like halls, live in college, and being able to, it's a very unique time, able to interact and engage with hundreds of people living in under the same roof, but it's just not had that opportunity so far. So it's that we're ready and bold to go out and enjoy engaging with people, but also that others will be, other students will be, who've been thinking about deeper things. I mean, lockdown's been quite lonely and a really hard time for some. Maybe people have been thinking about deeper things and they want to ask Christians about faith. Collingwood is quite a small CU and a really big student, like a big college, small CU. But we're able to establish a presence and be able to engage with everyone. That'd be really great. Thank you.
Well, thanks so much, David. That's great. It's great to see you and hear from you. And we'll be praying for all of those things. And now David's youth leaders when he was at Rock were Katie and Dan Hark. And Katie has very kindly offered to lead us in prayer now for David and for other students as they go back to another university term this coming week. So thank you, Katie.
Let's pray for our young people now. Dear God, we know that the past year has been so challenging for many of us, but this morning we want to particularly lift up to our young people. We thank you for David, who we've just heard from. We thank you, Lord, that you've surrounded him with flatmates and a supportive church family. And we thank you, Lord, that he can go back to university, Lord, and have that there, Lord. We pray for so many of them, Lord, including David, who are facing struggles with discipline and motivation with work, which is understandable given the circumstances. But we pray, Lord, that you would keep them going and be with them in their work, Lord. And in particular for David, we pray, Lord, and thank you, Lord, that he has the opportunity to be a co-leader of ECU. And we ask, Lord, that you would be with him and with the CU as they reach out to the other students, Lord, and give them the hope of Jesus. And we pray, Lord, that given the unusual circumstances of COVID, Lord, that they would, that the students would be really receptive to hearing this good news and this hope, Lord. So we ask for David and pray, Lord, that you would be with him. And for our other young people, Lord, who have faced so many changes and uncertainty in the last year, Lord, with the current COVID and with all the restrictions, Lord, we ask, Lord, that you would be with them. They have not been able to be able to meet with their friends. They've had to be flexible and adapt to online classes. They've had to deal with the unknown about their exams and manage sudden changes to their future plans that they have been working so hard towards. We pray, God, that you would be with them as they wait for further advice from the government and education establishments as to when and how they may return to university and what this looks like. We know this is still will look really different from what they may have been expecting and hoping for from their university experience. We pray, God, that for the young people that have been working so hard towards their A-levels and GCSE exams that have been cancelled, Lord, and we pray for patience and resilience for our young people as they face these changes and the unknown ahead, Lord. We pray for endurance and perseverance to continue with their education in such a different format from what they're used to. And we pray that you would continue to help them to keep focused on their studies. We pray for young people's friendships with their peers, which are so important and have been difficult to establish at this time. We pray, Lord, that the good friendships will continue to grow and develop despite these restrictions. We pray, Lord, that you would surround our young people with other Christian friends who can encourage each other in their faith and their walk with you. We thank you that primary and secondary schools have been able to return and that young people have been able to return to a sense of normality. We pray, though, that you will be with them as they adjust and settle back into life in the classroom. And we pray for all our young people's mental health as some may be battling with things such as loneliness, motivation, fear, amongst other things that have been brought on or exacerbated by these unusual times. We ask you would be close to them and help them as they face these challenges. We thank you for all the teaching, the teachers and all the support staff who work with within all the many areas of education, including so many within our own congregation. We thank you for all the amazing hard work they have been doing to allow our young people to keep on with their studies despite the COVID restrictions. We ask, Lord, for continued energy for them and that you would also be present with them during their many adjustments and unknowns and fears that they may also be facing. Thank you, Lord, that you are God God in heaven and that you are ruler over all. Thank you, Lord, that you love and care for us and that you have a plan for each one of our lives, even as this sometimes looks different from our own plans and hopes for our lives. May these promises and truths be a real certainty to our young people during these times, and that this may give them a real sense of peace and calm for their futures. And I just want to, as we remember, Lord, Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, and plans to give you a hope and a future. Amen.
Thank you, Katie. It really is so encouraging to hear from young people from Rock who are trusting in Jesus as they go on to the next phase. So thank you very much, David, as well. So, Rock Kids, where are you? Do you want to come forward and open your chat boxes? And I've got a question to ask you. And that question is, what do you think the word respect means? Open my chat box. To listen, say the Rals, kindness, they're both great ones. Being polite to someone, the Dukes. Lovingness, honour, be gentle. Be polite from the Peckhams. Those are great answers. Kindness, listening, politeness, love, honour, gentleness. Those are all brilliant answers. So let's look at a verse, a couple of verses in the Bible where the word respect is used. I'll read them out to you. So 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 12 and 13, and this is from the International Children's Bible. Now, brothers, we ask you to respect those people who work hard with you, who lead you in the Lord and teach you. Respect them with a special love because of the work they do with you. So I think you are all on the right track, that in this context, we're asked to respect those people who work hard with us and who lead us in the Lord. So the Bible links it to people who lead us in the Lord and teach us about Jesus. And this idea of respecting with a special love because of the work they do with you. And I wondered who you could think of in your lives who does that, who teaches you about Jesus. If you want to type your answers into the chat box again, that would be great. We've got lots of, mums and dads. We've got a Mike from the Mercers. Mike and Daddy from the Peckhams. That's great. Yeah, so we all have a number of people in our lives, don't we, who teach us about Jesus and who care about it. They don't only teach us because it's their job or because they're your parents or your Sunday school teacher. They care about you knowing him, and they take really seriously what God asks us to do in the Bible. And that leads us, I think some of you know already, that we were hoping today to say a special thank you to Mike for his wonderful KDD sessions during lockdown. We've got teachers and Mike from the RALs, teachers as well. So during lockdown, as most of you know, Mike organised a daily devotion, kids' daily devotion it was called, which was some lighthearted fun and some Bible teaching for the children every single day into our inboxes. And it was loved by the children at ROP and parents alike. And then on Fridays, we had a special live KDD live session, which was half an hour, and we came together and sang a few songs, told a few jokes. Mike read a Bible story and explained it, and it was a brilliant anchor for the children during lockdown and a wonderful way of keeping in touch with church family. I'm sure a lot of thought and planning and preparation went into it. And Naomi Rowell had the idea of getting the kids together to prepare a card and a present for Mike, which Dawn has, and I think we'll present to him. He's on annual leave, so we're not going to ask him to say anything, but Dawn has got that to give to Mike now. And we just want to say the biggest thank yous, Mike.
You should.
Thank you very much. You want to see the card?
Oh, yes, please.
This is really, wow. Well, I'll show you the picture on the front, which is lovely. But what's amazing is the kids inside have all done stuff. Oh, my goodness. That's fantastic. Oh, thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, it's a thank you very much as well. It was absolutely brilliant. And thank you to Rachel Matthews, who made sure it was all safe online and did lots of the admin behind it, and anyone else who was involved. It really was a brilliant thing for the kids in lockdown, and we're all so grateful for it. And so in place of a children's song now, the ROP kids have prepared a song that was a real KDD classic. Jessica Mercer chose it for them to perform for all of you. And it's called Who Is This Man? And we really just want to say a big thank you for KDD. The audio on it is quite quiet, so you might want to turn up your audio, or you may prefer to keep your audio as it is, but we hope you enjoy it.
King of kings, he's the Lord of lords. He can heal the sick, he can calm the storm.
He's the Son of God, he can save us from sin, and he calls us to follow him.
Jesus never mind troubled legacies, knowing it is too big a thing. Jesus trust in what this is most called.
He's the Lord of lords. He can heal the sick, he can calm the storm.
He's the Son of God, he can save us from sin, and he calls us to follow him.
Jesus and his friends caught in a storm, looking like they're gonna drown.
Jesus shouted, quiet,
and the storm was gone.
He's the Son of God, he can save us from sin, and he calls us to follow him.
Only God can do that. Who is this man?
He's the Son of God, he can save us from sin, and he calls us to follow him.
Yes, he calls us to follow him.
Aren't we part of the best church family? That was amazing, you guys. And thank you again to Mike and to everyone involved in KDD. It really was absolutely brilliant. So now is the time to head to Rock Bible Club. For those of you who follow the material, Rachel Matthews and Bev Mercer prepared it this week. So if you head out at this stage, if that's what you do. And then I'll hand over to Aileen Marshall, who's going to read to us from Galatians, and then to Matt Peckham, our assistant minister, who will bring God's word to us.
Thank you. So we're reading from Galatians chapter 4, from verse 12 to 20. Paul writes, "Formerly, when you did not know God, you were slaves to those who by nature are not gods." Oh, sorry, I've started at verse 8, apologies. "I plead with you, brothers and sisters, become like me, for I became like you. You have done me no wrong. As you know, it was because of an illness that I first preached the gospel to you. Even though my illness was a trial to you, you did not treat me with contempt or scorn. Instead, you welcomed me as if I were an angel of God, as if I were Christ Jesus himself. What has happened to all your joy? I can testify that if you could have done so, you would have torn out your eyes and given them to me. Have I now become your enemy by telling you the truth? Those people are zealous to win you over, but for no good. What they want is to alienate you from us so that you may have zeal for them. It is fine to be zealous, provided the purpose of good is good, and to be so always, not just when I am with you. My dear children, for whom I am again in the pains of childbirth until Christ is formed in you, how I wish I could be with you now and change my tone, because I am perplexed about you.
Thank you very much, Aileen, and thank you, Heather, for that. And apologies from me. I think I've twice stuffed up the PowerPoint. So it's not neither Heather nor Aileen, it's me. So I'm sorry about that behind the scenes. It's good to be with you. I'm going to pray, and we're going to look at this passage in Galatians together. Father God, we thank you again for your word. We thank you for your goodness to us. Thank you for the ways in which you have preserved us and the ways in which you keep us having a faith in the Lord Jesus. And we admit that we are fragile and often weak in our faith as well. And we pray, Lord, that you would strengthen us this morning. Thank you for your words. Please, would you help me to speak in a way in which we can hear your voice. So Father, please be with us in this time together, and we pray that because of our time together listening to you, we will love you and the Lord Jesus more. Amen. Sin needs a plausible environment to thrive. Sin needs a plausible environment to thrive. And the same is true with a distorted gospel, a sort of false version of the good news of Jesus. If that's to thrive, it needs a plausible environment for it to thrive. Just in the last 6 months, I've read and come across two reports from an organization called 31-8, and they deal with looking at safeguarding issues and problems that perhaps arise in the church. Now, details aside, there's the familiarity that crops up, and that is that often when things go wrong in the church, there's an environment around it which has enabled it to happen. And that's not particularly what we're thinking specifically about this morning, but the point is this, is that it is good to be alerted to how bad stuff flourishes so that we can arm ourselves against it. And that's a little bit of like what something which Paul is doing this morning as we come back to Galatians. So we've come back to Galatians after we spent our time celebrating Easter last week. And you'll remember that Paul is speaking into a situation into this church where these young Christians, a young church without a Jewish background, have been tempted to come under the Jewish law. And Paul calls that in 4 verse 9, which we saw last time, he calls that becoming enslaved over again. That's his words. He uses that idea of slavery to describe what's happening when we think we need to add something on top of the righteousness which we get from Jesus. And you can imagine perhaps how that might have worked. It's something perhaps of a premium package. That yes, you've joined a church, you've believed in Jesus Christ, but really, if you want to carry on now, well, the way to carry on is like this. And there's some false teachers amongst them saying, look, this is the premium package. We're the ones that can really help you progress now. This is really how you're going to be righteousness. And Paul calls this use of the law a slavery. It's a DIY righteousness. Now, as we've been going through Galatians, there may have been some of us thinking, well, is that really relevant to us? Perhaps we might even come across verses like the one after our passage this morning in verse 4:21, where Paul says, tell me, you who want to be under the law. And perhaps we think, well, that's not me. Who wants to be under the law? Who wants to be a slave? well, these things need an environment to survive, don't they? The devil's not stupid. He's going to make sure that if anything comes into the church to take us away from Jesus, it's not going to be particularly obvious. And as we go on, I think perhaps we might bear two things in mind. Well, firstly, and I hope this doesn't come to a shock to any of you, but firstly, this side of heaven, we cannot do anything perfectly. I hope that doesn't come as a shock to you, but it also means that we don't believe anything perfectly. So I'm so thankful here at Rock that we know the grace of the Lord Jesus. We know the true gospel, and not least because we've enjoyed time in Galatians to be reminded of it. But of course, in our sinfulness, we don't believe yet perfectly. And secondly, belief and action is a bit of a two-way street. So of course, we have our belief and we hope that our action will follow from our belief. But also it's a two-way street because our actions and what we want to do after a time can start to form what we believe. If we live a certain way for long enough, it'll shape what we think. And in both cases, we're tempted, or perhaps the temptation is out there for us to be aware of a DIY righteousness. And it sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? Nobody chooses slavery. Laura and I are reading a book with the children at the moment, a series in which, I won't give away the details in case you want to read it yourself, but you need to know that there's some monsters in this book. And some of the monsters, it transpires, choose to be the monsters. There is something that an evil person whispers to them, a temptation, and they choose to be enslaved. Well, we're certainly not in the same situation as the Galatians. Thankfully and mercifully, we don't have false teachers amongst us asking us to observe Jewish customs. However, we know that the law of God is good, don't we? And we know that it shows us how to please him. And in light of that, well, perhaps we might think, well, we can see how quickly that becomes a means of gauging just how right we are of God. Or perhaps there's a situation similar, which we might be tempted to the idea of an inner circle. You can well imagine that these false teachers have come in saying, look, we are the real deal. We're the elite here. And there's a sort of inner circle. And we'll confirm you if you confirm us. And you can come in and you can be more Christian. You can pursue righteousness with God in a better way. So the question is, could we drift towards slavery without even knowing? Is that possible? Well, Paul certainly saw that in the Galatians. And the remedy, well, what's the remedy? The remedy really is there in 5 verse 1. If you have a Bible in front of you, this little section of Paul's argument, which we began really in chapter 4, ends in chapter 5 verse 1. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. And so that is the remedy. And when Paul shows us what adding to Jesus can entail, we'll want to run a mile from it. But these Galatians don't seem to be able to see what's happening. And Paul is perplexed. From his point of view, he's thinking, why can't you see this? And so here in our passage this morning, in 4 verse 12, Paul takes a different tack. He says, look, I'm going to show you what's really going on. He's going to look at their experience. And that's quite a powerful way of arguing, isn't it? I find that one of the most persuasive things about the Bible, that when I look at the world and experience it around me, it confirms and verifies that what the Bible says is true. And so Paul says, look, you've heard some rational argument now. In the previous part of my letter, you've heard the theology. Well, look relationally at what's happening. If you still don't believe me that these guys are bad news, if you still don't believe me, take a look at what is happening. And Paul is lifting the lid on what is going on. He's unmasking the slavery because, of course, it doesn't seem like slavery to them. They need to be shown, and we need to see that anything that adds to Jesus is incompatible, that DIY righteousness is opposed to Christ and it is oppressive to Christians. Well, why don't they get it? Well, they don't get it because this sort of righteousness is persuasive and it's coercive. It is attractive and it bends you to its own ends. And really, this is a passage which speaks to churches, but it speaks to their teachers and leaders as well. Now, as we said before, we're not in the same situation, but we might look on this case study and learn from it, and learn from Paul, and learn to treasure the freedom which we know we have and which we believe in. So the question for us this morning is this: how can we grasp more of the freedom that we have in order to expel any temptations to add to the Lord Jesus Christ and his work on the cross? And Paul highlights the freedom we have, a freedom through sonship. And as we grasp it, all those other things will shrink away. So how does he begin? Well, Paul lifts the lid on two unseen realities. There's two unseen realities which the Galatians seem oblivious to, and Paul passionately wants to point it out. Verse 12, I plead with you, brothers and sisters, become like me, for I became like you. You did me no wrong. As you know, it was because of an illness that I first preached the gospel to you. And even though my illness was a trial to you, you did not treat me with contempt or scorn. Instead, you welcomed me as if I were an angel of God, as if I were Christ Jesus himself. Where then is your blessing of me now? I can testify that if you could have done so, you would have torn out your eyes and given them to me. Have I become your enemy by telling you the truth? Do you see how Paul changes his tone here? He's pleading with them. And in fact, we've been through quite a few sermons now in Galatians, but now is the first time that Paul actually asks the Galatians to do anything. He says to them, verse 12, become like me as I became like you. That's quite a bold thing to say to anyone, isn't it? Become like me. But you see the way that Paul argues it, rather persuasively and cleverly, become like me. Well, only in as much as I'm like the way you were. So go back. What's happened? And in what way was that? In what way did Paul become like the Galatians? Well, he became like the Galatians were because he became someone who freed himself from law and he embraced the cross of Jesus. And that is how the Galatians were. And so Paul says, you must become like me, and that is freedom. What did that look like for them? Well, they accepted Paul. They did him no wrong. But now Paul says, look what's happened. This can't be good, the way that you're behaving and the teaching you're listening to. Why? Because it's changed you. Can you see that? He's saying to the Galatians, look, we used to be on the same side, but now you've changed, says Paul. And you've changed. Why? Why am I your enemy? Because I proclaim the truth to you. And so this teaching that they've been caught up in has made them opposed to Paul and opposed to the truth. Well, why are they anti-Paul? Well, we know Paul's gospel, don't we? We know the gospel that he brought to them, that he first preached to them, verse 13, was the gospel of the Lord Jesus crucified. And they're opposed to Paul because that is the way of religion. All religion is opposed to the cross because the cross is an offense, because it strips religion of its power. Paul will go on later in Galatians to say that there's an offense to the cross, which these false teachers want to avoid. And if you're not quite convinced that the cross of Jesus is offensive, well, perhaps think about gently telling a friend that every good thing that they do will not earn their way into heaven. that it will stand no credit with God. That's a hard thing to explain to anybody. In fact, it's not just bad things that keep us from God. In fact, the Lord Jesus came for sinners. Actually, what's dangerous is our good works. It's our good deeds that can keep us away from God, because they're the things which tell us we don't need him. And so that kind of adding on and doing our own thing, the DIY righteousness, it's an attractive package. Do you want to avoid persecution for Jesus? Do you want to feel more righteous? Do you want to progress in the Christian life? Do you want to be thought well of by people at church? Do you want to be thought well of by the pastor? Well, say the teachers, here's what you need to do. So this has led to them being opposed to the truth. And it's happened, the second thing that Paul lifts the lid on, and much more, it's much more sinister. It's happened because of manipulation. Look at verse 17. Those people, and he's talking about the teachers, which he later described as the agitators, the people that are bothering you and actually oppressing you. They are zealous to win you over, but for no good. What they want is to alienate you from us, from the apostles and from the truth. And that being zealous, the ESV Bible translates that as being made much of. I mean, it is literally zealousy, but it's that idea that teachers would say would make a big deal of people, make them feel great. Well, why do they want to do that? Well, they want to do that because they want to alienate the Galatians from Paul. They want to say, yeah, you know, Paul is, he's old hat and he's a bit embarrassing, and it's great that he started you on the Christian journey, but really, we're the people to be listening to. And why do they do it? Well, they do it because they want the Galatians to be zealous about them. These teachers want to be a big deal. And Paul's saying, look, Paul's saying, you are being played here. You're being flattered, and we all like to be flattered and made much of, but really it's because they're out for their own gain. You can imagine how they might have flattered these young Christians, a group of people coming from Jerusalem, the big city, the big center, saying, well, look, you, and it's great to have non-Jewish people. It's great that the church is becoming more diverse. It's so brilliant that you're here. And in fact, you know, if you really try hard enough, perhaps you could really make something of yourself in the church. Perhaps one day you could be a leader as well. And look, we can show you how to do these things. And do you notice a common factor between the people teaching and the people listening? The common factor is it's about us, isn't it? So there are people there in Galatia that want to be made much of. And what are they doing? They're using others' desire to be made much of to make that happen. That's what we would call it's a real toxic relationship, isn't it? And what happens is a vicious circle, because if we move away from the cross, then the need to assert our own righteousness grows as well. Because justification is a verdict. We're to be seen to be righteous. Someone has to see us to be righteous, to declare us righteous. Well, if that's not God, then who will it be? It'll be people. And as people confirm our righteousness, we'll get further away from the cross. And as we get further away from the cross, we'll look more to people. And on it goes. What do others think? How am I doing? And all of a sudden, a sort of performance culture has grown up before anyone's noticed it. And we would be naive to think that the church was immune from these kind of things. So here's a really healthy warning, isn't it, from Paul, to be alert to those things. And as I studied the passage this week, well, it's no more clear that this is applicable to me as a minister. What can happen? Well, I hope it doesn't surprise you that ministers can be tempted as well. it perhaps happens something a bit like this, where a pastor can be in the situation or find themselves drifting into the situation where they need their flock for self-worth. Perhaps they're in circles with other ministers, just casually talking about church. How's your church doing? Great. Well, you know, we baptized 5 people last year. We ran 5 Christianity Explored courses. How are you doing? And of course, it's not meant in a bragging way. It's just talking about church life. But what's the temptation? Well, what if I can't match up? What will people think? And that's unhealthy, isn't it? And there may be fear as well. It can work the other way. There could be fear. What do people think of me? A friend of mine some years ago is an assistant minister at a large FIEC church. And I can't recall if it was him that preached or somebody else, but there was a sermon that was given, which basically laid out a biblically orthodox understanding of sex and relationships. And in the following week, every single staff member of that church received an anonymous letter telling them that they were wrong and bigoted and so on. And you can imagine the fear of others that causes. And that's true for pastors because it's true for us in general, isn't it? Seeking approval. What will they think of me? Will people think I'm a good Christian? I'm doing well in the Christian life? Am I doing enough? And in the extreme, that can have a wrong zeal for leaders, can't it? Perhaps people will be proud that they're in so-and-so's church or whatever it might be. And Paul wants to show us that anything added to Jesus is incompatible. So this way of thinking is incompatible. It can lead to being opposed to the truth, and it's oppressive. And in fact, Paul will go on to say in his letter that there is biblical precedent for this, that the way of slavery and the way of freedom are incompatible and against one another, and we should cast out that sort of thinking. But do you know what? Paul wants to encourage them, which we know, the freedom we have in Jesus, it breaks all of that. And it will involve getting back to the cross because true freedom is cross-shaped. 5 verse 1 again is for freedom that Christ, by dying on the cross, by taking that curse for us, has set us free. Stand firm then. Now, perhaps the cynic might be thinking, well, you know, Paul's just playing the same game, really. He's trying to win them over. And really, it's just a big power play, trying to win them back. But Paul isn't anti-zeal. He's saying, look, zeal for the right thing is good. It doesn't even have to be for Paul. Verse 18, it is fine to be zealous, provided the purpose is for good, and to be so always, not just when I am with you. Be zealous for the good thing. I'm not concerned about you being zealous for me when I'm there. If I'm not there and you're zealous for good things, then that is great. Because for Paul, it's not about him. It's not about the Galatians making much of Paul, but making much of Jesus. Look down at verse 19. My dear children, for whom I am again in the pains of childbirth until Christ is formed in you, how I wish I could be with you and change my tone, because I am perplexed about you. Paul is in a pastoral agony, just wanting to give birth, to see the new life of a church which is free in Christ. It is a pain and agony which longs to see a Jesus-shaped church because freedom is cross-shaped. He's not in it for himself. He doesn't want the Galatians to say, oh, Pastor Paul, that was a fantastic sermon. He wants them to say, Pastor Paul, isn't Christ fantastic? Thank you for showing me that. Isn't Jesus great? I am again in the pains of childbirth, he says, until Christ is formed in you. That might be quite a weird image, but I think it's a really wonderful image. And can you imagine your inner being, your essence, being morphed and shaped until Jesus himself is there? Isn't that amazing? Isn't that what we want from church? And how different is that from these teachers who want to create versions of themselves, that want to see a love formed for themselves? No, Paul is not like that. He wants to see Christ formed in them. Like John the Baptist says, he sees Jesus, and John the Baptist says, doesn't he? He says, I must decrease, he must increase. To make much of Jesus is how we stand in our freedom. And we make the most of our freedom when we make much of Jesus. And we should pray that that would be the case for all of those that lead and teach amongst us, that we would want to see Christ formed. For that is freedom, isn't it? I can't see you all, sadly, because we're not gathered together. But I look at my screen and there I see James Marshall, and we desire to see, I long to see Jesus formed in him. And there's Katie, the Jesus version of Katie. And Ross, the Jesus version of Ross. And Dawn, the Jesus version of Dawn. That's what we long to see, how incredible. But as much as that happens individually, how much more so with the whole body of Christ? That's what I think Paul is really getting at as he looks at the church. Last week was Easter, and we celebrated an amazing fact on that first Easter Sunday that the body of Jesus was nowhere to be found in that tomb. There was no body. And of course, Jesus appeared in his resurrection body and he ascended to heaven. And so where is the body of Christ? Well, it is in heaven. But of course, Paul himself says, well, the church is the body of Christ. That's his image of the church, isn't it? I wonder if some of you might remember, and this is probably going back to the 1990s, I think, Magic Eye Pictures. Do you remember Magic Eye Pictures? And they were kind of computer generated and they looked random dot pixels, colorful, weird patterns. They didn't look like anything. And the idea with the Magic Eye picture was that if you stared at it long enough, I can't remember the technique, but I could never do it. But apparently, if you stared long enough, a 3D image would emerge from the page of a shark or a dinosaur or something. It would emerge. Well, in a way, people are to look at the church, and if they look long enough and carefully enough, they will see Jesus. That's what Paul desires. That's what ministry in freedom looks like, free to want to make much of Jesus. Can you imagine that? That's incredible, isn't it? Can you imagine the outsider saying, oh, this Jesus that you talked about, this Jesus who you say is risen from the dead and he's in heaven and that's why we can't see him, this Jesus which, well, where is he and what's he like? Can you imagine if the outsider began to see Jesus by looking at his people? Wouldn't that be incredible? And that's what I'm doing, Paul says. And Paul says to the Galatians, well, you used to accept it. You used to love that too. They accepted Paul as an ambassador of God, like Jesus himself, even though he was going through trials. Even though he was ill, it was a burden to them. He says in verse 13, as you know, it's because of an illness that I first preached the gospel to you. And even though my illness was a trial to you, you did not treat me with contempt or scorn. Instead, you welcomed me as if I were an angel of God, as if I were Christ Jesus himself. That's wonderful. That's the love we want to show when someone says that I'm going to show you Jesus. And these Galatians, they loved that. Even though Paul was ill, and he was a burden and he was a trial to them. Perhaps he was a bit embarrassing, but they didn't hold him with contempt or scorn. They embraced the cross that was taught by him. Paul says, I can testify myself that if you could have done, you would have gouged your eyes out and given them to me. He's saying, look, that's how passionate you were. You would have said, look, I'd give my right arm to hear you tell me about Jesus. At where the cross is welcome and clung to. And that leads to a free church. Teachers teaching to see Christ formed and the church embracing that cross-shaped life. Being zealous for good and free from fear. Because all that kind of performance stuff and all of this teaching from these false teachers that want to add on stuff, well, they don't love the Galatians. You know, religion doesn't love you. And God doesn't love us because we're great. God loves us because he's great. Now that's freedom, isn't it? That is freeing. And so we turn away from ourselves and towards Jesus. Become like me, Paul says. I rejected slavery just as you did, and I embrace the cross and Jesus, and I long to see him formed in the church. And when you do that, you won't need to assert your righteousness in the eyes of others. In fact, the devil's traps and temptations will begin to fade away, because those temptations, well, they only work if the bait works. So are we tempted by being loyal to someone else? Well, no, if we're with Jesus, we're loyal to him first. Do we have a fear of being rejected? Well, no, we fear God who has accepted us. Are we tempted by the inner ring or an elite way? Well, Jesus is our brother. He's made us a co-heir. There's nothing that's going to get better than that to move to. Are we tempted by flattery, to be made much of? Well, Jesus is the antidote to that too, because Jesus has made much of us, even when we were sinners. And what about failure? Being exposed as a failure, inadequate, shamed. Well, guess what? Jesus covers that too. So you see, in a way, Jesus is the ultimate spiritual safeguard. And we're free to love and serve him. In fact, we're free to serve without fear. And in a way, we're free to not serve without fear. Because it doesn't matter, it doesn't change what God thinks of us. And I hope you find that encouraging. I hope you find that encouraging, perhaps in the area of service as well, particularly because I know that in lockdown, we're not really functioning as church, and we miss those things, don't we? The music, the tech team, the encouragers, the words of wisdom, the creche, the acts of kindness, the impromptu prayer, and they're missed. And God has made us to be doing those things. But the lack of them or not functioning like that doesn't leave us on the outside, and it doesn't make us any less in God's eyes as a Christian, because he loves us. Nothing has changed. For freedom, Christ has set us free. So let's treasure that, and that will safeguard us from falling back again into slavery. Let's pray together. Father God, we praise you for the Lord Jesus. We praise you that although we are unworthy sinners, he has made much of us by loving us in grace to set us free. Please would you help us to be a church which lives out that freedom and enjoys it in fellowship and love with one another, as we encourage and pray and hope that the Lord Jesus himself is formed amongst us. Would you protect us and keep us from any form of what Paul here calls slavery that would move us away from the cross? Please keep us from that, we pray, in your mercy. Amen.
Matt, thank you so much for that. Our final song now continues to remind us of where our true identity is found and where true freedom is found. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. Let's sing together the wonderful words of this song, In Christ Alone.
fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness.
Before we bring our time of worship together to a close, we've just got a few notices. So the Band of Brothers, which is a preaching group at Rock for those who are newer to preaching, meets this afternoon in our 4 p.m. service. And Darren Mercer will be preaching to us from Ruth chapter 3. It's the same Zoom link. So do come along at 4 o'clock this afternoon to a time of worship together then. And then finally, we've been reading as a church a brilliant book written by a pastor of one of our sister churches in North Cambridge, Graham Bynan, and it's called God's New Community. And we are in our 4 p.m. service on the 25th of April. We're going to be discussing it. So if you haven't been able to buy a copy yet, there's still time to do so, but it really is a fantastic book and we'll be discussing it on the 25th of April, so do join us for that. And as we bring our time of worship to a close, let's unmute our microphones and say together the words of the grace. And then after this, if you've got time to stay on and join a breakout room, that would be great, where we can continue to catch up together. So let's read this out loud together. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ,
and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us all, evermore. Amen.